Good morning, everybody. This is Jeff Galvin of Solid Canine Training, and this is the Wake the Fuck Up with Jeff show, and I've got a wonderful guest. Her name is Kelley, and Kelley lives on the West Coast, and Kelley is a – we've never actually met in person, but we've met online many times through either social media, or she's also part of our Inner Circle, which is our more intensive monthly training program. But I really wanted to talk to Kelley just because of the incredible success she's having with her dogs, and just explain to people how far dogs can come when you use the right methodology, the right tools. You also put in the hard work, though, you have a nice mix of both a reward-based program and a punitive-based program. So Kelley, thanks first of all for joining me. I really, really appreciate it for having you on the show. Talk to me about even finding us, like what was going on with your dogs?
Sure. So I'll try to keep it brief, but I do want to give just kind of a backstory so you kind of understand where it all started. So back in July, we adopted these two dogs. They, you know, came together from the same shelter. No problems together in the shelter. All good. Obviously, they'd been there quite some time. Don't know their backstory. Not that it matters, but, you know, all that good stuff. When we got them, I did not know much about dog training. Really anything, which was naive of me to bring these dogs in and not know, but knowing what I know now, I will not make that mistake. So this is me saying to everyone, if you're thinking about buying a dog, adopting a dog, do your research first. Like I know Jeff preaches it, but truly, truly, it, you know, I could have saved so much time, but you know, that doesn't matter now.
Right.
Yeah. You know, when they first came in, I did say, I want to crate train them. I want them to eat in their crates, kind of just to avoid any bad situations, not knowing them and kind of how they may interact. So I did do that right. However, didn't really put any like rules and structure in place with them. So they definitely had kind of free reign of the house. You know, I left toys out. I started training them, but just very casually on, you know, like sit and stay, nothing too wild. And then kind of over the course of having them after a few months, they did get into a few disagreements, I would say. So they kind of, not full on fights, but just a few times were like a little scuffle. We had to break up. We just thought, well, that's dogs being dogs. And then one day, a couple of months ago, I don't know what caused it. They were in the yard and they got into a fight. And it was not the type of fight where you could yell and say, hey, break it up. I mean, it was not great. And so at that point, we kind of were at this weird place where we go, well, A, like we need the dogs to be safe. You know, we need them to be able to be safe. We can't have this happen. We don't want anyone injured, dying. I mean, that would be horrible. But we're also not going to live a lifestyle of like crate and rotate or gates up. You know, like, yes, we did that initially because we needed them to be safe as we started training them. But we need them to coexist. We need this to be a good household. We love them both. We're not sending them back to the shelter. We're not giving them up. We're going to make it work. And so that's when I really started looking online and I started to see the like positive training and then also kind of more of the, you know, punitive based training. And for me at that point in time, I had been just doing training with treats.
Right.
But I felt like I just needed more because they are bigger dogs. They're 55, 60 pounds. I really needed them to understand like what is okay and what is not okay. And I needed to do it quickly. And so I found you, there were a couple of other folks I followed, but eventually I wasn't getting anywhere with like watching a YouTube video here and watching a YouTube video there. Like I really needed structure for myself as well and be able to follow a system because it was too overwhelming. So then I started listening to your podcast. I found your Patreon. I found Green to Graduate. And it was.
You dove in. So how, when they had their first fight, how many months have you had them?
2 months.
Oh, there was your first major fight.
Yeah.
So 2 months into it and they started having a big fight. Looking back, do you think like if you got to do it all over again, which it's a weird way to think because I don't live my life like this, but do you think during those first 2 months you did, nobody says, I can't wait for 2 months from now till my dogs fight. Like nobody says that, but looking back, do you feel that there's things that you probably now that you know what you know should have been doing and should not have been doing?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, from the beginning, we should have just been, I guess, more strict on just training from the beginning. I mean, we didn't, they just kind of, like I said, they just could kind of roam around the house. And on top of that, the male, he's a younger male, he would chase shadows. And he had this like really bad problems. Ooh. With it. He would bounce off the walls. He would just run, like he hit the sliding glass door once. And again, I didn't know a ton. So I'm like, what is this guy doing? He was just constantly on. And that was a part of training as well, is just calming the mind. And just like now they can just be on place, take a nap. It's all good. He's not running around like a total psycho. And I think that's helped a lot too. So I think just, yes, if you're asking me, would I have done things differently? Of course I would have done things differently. Right. I would have, and I will in the future.
Right.
Well. Yeah.
How, you know, when you get a dog from a shelter, especially, and I've obviously, I'm always been a, however anybody wants to get a dog, I'm a fan of just, mm-hmm. you know, just train the dog. I'm more on the training side than yes. the acquiring side. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the kind of thing where when you get a dog, we all get dogs for human companionship. We get them for love and affection. We get them for like, you know, just we're having a crappy day and they make us feel good. I mean, that's why we get a dog. We like to pet them. We like to cuddle with them. I mean, that's why I think the majority of people get family pets. How much of your heart overtook, like, did you make excuses for your dogs, do you think, because of your heart at the beginning?
All the time.
Yeah.
All the time. I still have to stop myself. Yeah. And I think that's one thing that was really helpful with you is that you do, you know, it is about rewards in the beginning. It is. But at the end of the day, dogs are very opportunistic. They're going to take advantage of you if they can. I mean, I've seen that with my own dogs. I still constantly have to be on them about certain things. I mean, the other day, the dog came in and he was like, woo, and jumped on the couch. And I was like, no, like, what are you? That's, we're right. just, don't do that here. This right. is not, right. you know, but they see a small opening and they take it. But yeah, I mean, it is hard sometimes. And we didn't have them that long, but I have had dogs in the past for 10, 11 years.
Right.
I think about that dog and I'm like, man, if I started today, if they were still here, could I have done this? Because my heart is so invested in them and love them so much. But I will say it has actually been so much better for our relationship. I feel like the dogs like really respect us now. They understand what we want of them. We still give them love. We still
right.
give them the best food. We still all this stuff. But at the end of the day, they know like, hey, these are the rules. This is what yeah. we get to go on hikes. We get to go out and have lunch, you know, at the bistro down the street.
Wow.
Do all these really, really fun things. And I think without the training, they, you know, they'd probably just be inside or in the backyard. And that's how I wanted to live with the dogs.
Right. I think that's a really great point that it's like you are forced into having a more structured, well-trained lifestyle pretty darn quick. Because 2 months is pretty darn quick where mm-hmm. a lot of people, I'm sure people, you know, I mean, there's tons of people that I know and I see people, you know, I mean, I've only lived down here for 9 months, but even in 9 months, I've seen the same dogs every day with the exact same horrific behaviors and like nothing has changed. Meanwhile, that dog could be a totally new dog in a month, you know? So, you know, in a way it's, you might even be thinking this, it's like, I'm glad we had these problems so quick mm-hmm. because so we can start addressing them and live a better life. I mean, one of the things that you mentioned really quickly though, but I really want to address is, do you think your firmness and your structure and your rules and you quote unquote cracking down on them has like made things worse or have made things better?
No, so much better. So much better. Yeah. Because they listen. I mean, before when they were just running around, you know, if I told them to come or, you know, out, get away from the other dog, they weren't listening. So there was no.
They knew like, you know, sit for reward. But then like, yeah. who the hell is Kelley? Right.
That's right. Yeah.
Right. Right.
That's right.
Right.
They're like, this is my house. I'm doing what I want. And bye. Who are you, lady? Like, cool. Thanks for letting us live here.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then after the fight is when you started getting nervous or concerned, and that's when you were like, I need to get a handle on this. And could you find local resources and don't name names or companies, but did you find any local resources, or was it confusing? I've often said, I'm so glad that I'm a dog trainer, because it seems like the marketplace is just so confusing, I think, for the average dog owner.
It's very confusing. And I will tell you, I did. So when it first happened, my husband and I were like, okay, we need to do a board and train. That was our first thought, right? We're like, we need to send them off to boot camp. They got to figure it out and they're going to get it together. And then, you know, I did actually talk to a couple. There's not really a lot local here. So one was in Idaho. Again, I'm not saying names or anything, and they seem great. Right. But everything was like a 6-month wait. And I don't have 6 months to wait. So it's like, okay, well, I have to do this myself. I have to figure it out, because they need to be able to get along. That's it. We have to live in a household where they can do that. Right. So there were a couple of trainers in Seattle. That's where I live, that I did see. But again, I just felt like it was something I had to take into my own hands immediately. Mm. And I also felt like, you know, I have to take some responsibility. Obviously, we did not do everything correct with the dogs from the beginning. And so I felt like I needed to be the one to train them and for them to really see, like, hey, I'm not going away. You know, I'm your handler. You live here. I do love you, but you have to follow what we're doing here.
Right.
I felt like if we sent them away, yes, the work would have been put in, but I didn't feel like I would have been teaching myself. And I think that was a big part of it as well in this whole
thing. That's a big, probably truth combination misconception about board and trains, because you're still getting, you're working with a trained dog now, but the dog does come back to the house thinking that at this location, I don't have to be a trained dog. So, but the cool thing is you have a trained dog. So now once you learn the lingo, the remote collar, or you know, the training methodology, like, someone's got to do all the reps. Like, you've done all the work and you know how hard it is. So it's like, you're paying someone to do the work with more knowledge than you, to try to troubleshoot, and then hopefully spend a lot of time, you know, training you and then giving you just a really good, you know, head start. So were you able to like even walk them down the street, or was that chaotic? Like, how bad was their obedience?
So we are very lucky. They are actually very good dogs. They did come there, you know, right away from day one. They slept in the crate at night. We would put them in there for little breaks. They would eat in there. No anxiety in the crates or anything like that. So we were very lucky in
that sense.
Really great.
It's really great.
You know, I try to focus on the positives of like, wow, you know, X, Y, and Z is bad, but A, B, and C are fantastic.
Which sometimes does keep us from we it makes us ignore the dog fighting. It's like, well, they're really sweet and smart. Yeah, they get into a fight, and yeah, I got to put away money for the vet bills, but I love them. So,
everything else. Yeah.
How bad was that fight? Was it vet stuff, or was it just like pulling apart?
So they actually got in two in one day. So the first time, like, they had some, you know, like scratches, we were able to get them pulled apart. And then right after that, we actually did take them out to do a walk together. They rode in the car fine. So we were like, okay, like, this seems like, you know, I don't know what this was over, but we're okay. And then that same night we let them outside in the yard, and it was just immediate. They just went nose to nose and just right away again. When it was like, okay, this is not going to work. We can't even let them out together without potentially something happening.
And it's really scary. It's very, very scary breaking up a dog. It is.
And they're very loud, you know, and the neighbors, you know, someone came out, they're like, oh, and they are pit bull mixes. So someone was like, it's not a pit bull mix. And then now you got people like judging the dogs, and it just turned into a whole thing. So I was like, okay, now it's turned into a lot.
Right. So you immediately, and you eventually you found us. Mm-hmm. And what, talk to me about that journey. Like, where did you started with, did you get the Green to Graduate program, or did you just start with just all of our free content?
So I started with free content because I just started looking online. And I will say too that I love how much is out there that trainers put out there. It's fantastic.
Agreed 100%.
But it can also be incredibly overwhelming. Like, who do I follow?
Yes.
What is the right approach? You know, and then you get some folks who are like, don't do this. Like, you hate your dog if you do this.
And that, then that's the part, that's that emotional manipulation that really is a big concern that keeps a lot of people from, I think, you know, success.
Am I still here? Okay, good.
Yeah, you froze, but you're still here now.
Yeah. Okay, I'm here. So I started doing that because I was just trying to figure out where to start and what to do. And obedience was obviously on my mind, but the main thing was, hey, I need them to be able to coexist.
Right.
And so I kind of started looking first at, you know, on YouTube, like, dogs fighting in the household, right? And then all roads led back to, hey, like, they need structure, they need rules. You got to start really implementing these different things, and obedience is a part of that. And you got to start doing this. And so then I started thinking, okay, how am I going to train and what am I going to use? And then I started reading up on the prong collar and the e-collar, and I started seeing trainers that had success. And then I found you guys and started listening to your podcast. Like I said earlier, I found the Patreon group, which was really, really great. And then I think I found you guys right during the time that you launched Green to Graduate, actually, because you're running a deal on it or something, I think, or maybe you had just launched it. And I just liked your approach. I just feel like you were very straightforward. The content that I had already seen from you was great. I love how real you are with everything. On your Instagram, you show the process. You know, a lot of times on Instagram or TikTok, you just see like the pretty final picture, and it's just not realistic. You know, I wanted to feel like, okay, I'm in it with somebody else. Like, they get it. They see there's like the messy middle, you know, because sometimes as a dog owner that doesn't know much and you're trying, you feel like a failure if your dog isn't getting it. Like, do I have the dumb dog? Am I the bad, you know?
Let's talk about that, because I'm a big advocate of showing the messy middle. And I always, when I mentor young dog trainers, I always say, of course you can show the before and after, because people we need to see results.
Absolutely.
You need to give people hope. It's like, there's hope. It's like, wow, that reminds me of my dog. Holy moly. Right. After 2 weeks, 3 weeks, that is possible. So I think that's important. But I think when you take a dog that's got, even not aggressive, just to take a dog that's totally untrained, out of control, jumping on couches, chasing shadows, which is an OCD behavior. And then you take a shadow chaser and you tell that dog, you tell, force, train that dog to do a downstay and ignore shadows. There's going to be some shaking going on. There's going to be a lot of, you know, it's like you gave up your heroin for, you know, you're sober now. And I think it's important to show the messy middle, and because folks like you need to see that, so you understand that it's part of the process and you're on the right path, so you don't think you're doing it wrong.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And you're absolutely right, because I did see these videos, right, of, oh, these dogs were fighting and now they're not, you know, because that's, again, where I started in my research. And that's great. I'm so glad to see they're awesome. But how did we get there?
Right.
Because I want to get there. Right. That's what. So it's just really helpful to see that, even just in a heel, right? Or a down. And what do you do when the dog gets up? I mean, you just let him get up, or how do you address it? Just all those
Nobody wants to. Nobody wants to talk about the firmness, the harshness, the light him up, the hard corrections. It seems like everybody's moving away from that. And I think it's because of social media pushback, obviously, you know, which is rampant. I mean, I'm sure you see it as well.
One thing I want to say on that, Jeff, sorry, I don't want to cut you off, it's less over time. So yes, in the beginning, it may seem like, oh, I'm using the remote a lot, but now it's so very little that I have to use it,
right?
You know, because even just them being under verbal command, they just listen better being obedient. So yes, there are a few occasions where I do have to use it, but it's not like every day I'm just like stimming, like, hey, you're just getting the stem. And so I think that, again, with the messy middle and the outcome, that's just helpful too, because sometimes I do think there's negativity online and people just maybe don't understand how it works. And I never want to hurt my dogs. Like, I'm never going to.
Nobody does.
I just want to live a fulfilled, wonderful, great life with them.
Right. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't think anybody goes, you know, wakes up in the morning and says, I can't wait to hurt my dogs.
I hope not.
But I hope not too. I'm sure there are people that exist like that. They probably do think of horrific things to do to animals as well as people, but nobody, no, you know, nobody in my circle, that's for sure. I think that one of the reasons why we get dogs and you are seeing barely using the collar and the dogs under voice control is because we don't back away. You did not back away from the messy middle. You most likely applied some pretty firm consequences for unacceptable behavior. So the dogs did have clarity. So you're not nagging your dogs every day. You're not nagging your dogs. It wasn't like, will you please stop? It's like, cut the fucking shit or it's going to suck. And you follow through. And they're like, if they didn't believe you, you made them believe you. So you found us through that. You made progress, but you still signed up for the inner circle. Is that because there was still a missing part?
So I signed up for the inner circle because, for me, it's easier to learn in a group. So I really enjoyed being able to see other people's issues. I know that sounds terrible. I don't want other people to have issues with their dogs, but it was just helpful to see, you know, others who were struggling with different things and how they might address it, even just for future. Like if my dog does this in the future, this is how I would address it. And so for me, that was really helpful because I just felt like, okay, I'm learning from these four other people, learning from you, seeing the videos, which was really great just to be able to understand the different behavior. Even now, my male dog is not often, but occasionally leash reactive. It really depends. Like if he sees a dog on the other side of the street that is just, he's not vibing with, you know, he's like, hey, I'm not into it. I'm going to growl at them. And so, you know, I probably wouldn't have known how to address that. I did buy the leash reactivity course as well. Yeah, but the inner circle just helped me because a few other owners were struggling with that. And so just with the loading. And then also I had done the obedience, but I felt like I needed the next level just with the dogs and the fighting situation. So.
Right. Yeah. And if people aren't familiar with the inner circle, it's a 4-week, we meet once a week for 90 days. It's up to 5 people and it's done by Zoom. And we talk like this as Kelley and I are doing now. And we give you homework and then she uploads videos and other people uploads videos. And then we dissect the videos. And I think the big thing with you, if I recall, was when you're teaching the out command, because was there resource guarding against you or just between the two dogs?
Just between the two.
The two dogs. Mm-hmm. And when we trained the out command, or whatever command it was, we're able to like literally slide the slider on the video to like, boom, right there, that frame. That's when you should have delivered something. But meanwhile, you waited 1 second longer, which is a lot of frames, you know, it's like whatever, 30 or 60 frames per second. So I think that's helpful. And then you mentioned seeing other people. One of the great things about the seminars that I used to do, I've retired from them after 8 years, but I would always tell people when there's 60 people there, I'm like, just because I'm working with this dog right here, you all should be paying attention because number one, your dog might start doing this, as you mentioned, or you might recognize one little thing that even though your dog doesn't do this, it might be relatable to you. Also, it's about dog training being everything. It's not just about one. It's not about one thing. It's about everything. And you're like, oh, so my dog doesn't do that, but can I use the same technique or similar technique for this? And I'm like, yeah, because it's the same theory. The theory is the theory is the theory. So, and you find us through the inner circle, and you're done with that now. You were in the last round. And did you find that, did that bring you up to the next level?
Yeah, definitely. It helped even just with a lot of little things, just with handler awareness on the walk and ways to address that, all the way up to, you know, the dogs being able to play together again or just be able to be in the same space. So yeah, it was really, really helpful. I'm really glad I did it. I would highly recommend it to anyone, even if there's just small things you want to tweak, because I'm not a professional dog trainer. I don't think most people are professional dog trainers. And like you said, there could be those little moments that I just don't know. I haven't done this. I don't see it. And so it's really, really helpful to have that information.
Bring awareness. Yeah. So how long has it been? How long have you actually owned them now?
So we got them at the end of July. Okay. So that month is kind of a wash.
That's months.
6 months.
Eight. So not a long time. Eight. Yeah, beginning of month eight. So you're like not even 6 months. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And
they're doing a lot better.
They're doing better now.
Yes. Yes. Another thing too is I was really nervous about the holidays because we were going to have a lot of people in and out, and being able to have them just sit on place and hang out was
how they do
everything. They did great. It was wonderful because I didn't want to have to crate them. I want them to be able to be out and be a part of what's going on. And it was fantastic. So just another
thing. So during the holidays, you had people over your house and the dogs were in place. And did they stay there the whole time other than maybe potty breaks?
Yeah.
So it's you know, so how were you mentally okay with that? Because a lot of people struggle with that. A lot of people are like, do you mean they have to stay there the whole time? Can't they like be released and walk amongst the crowd? And I'm like, no, they can stay there the whole time and just hang out. You know, why would you? They don't need to like be amongst us, because they're probably going to just like, you know, sit by the table and beg for food or go underneath the table and pick up scraps and possibly fight over those or just be annoying. And everybody doesn't like, you know, sorry, but everybody doesn't want a 60-pound pit bull, you know, walking amongst their feet, knowing that they used to fight. So, so how did you handle it mentally and your husband? Were you both on the same page with that?
Yeah, we were on the same page. And I think it's just, the alternative really is what putting them in the crate. And we don't have our crates in the same room. They're in a different room. It's where they sleep at night. So we wanted them to be able to be social and see people. And when they came out, you know, they got to sniff everybody. They still got pets. They, you know, we played games. They were able to leave place and come lay down next to us when we played games. But it honestly, it was just the safest thing for everybody. They got to hang out. They still were a part of the holidays, but we avoided any conflict. Right. We didn't have any issues. And in my eyes, that was the most important thing, because I, you know, you don't want to have to have them jumping on people or, you know, someone drops a piece of food and I don't notice it and they both go for it. And then it's just not worth it. It's not worth it.
So going back to when you said you were playing games and you release them and they just lay down and hung out. Do you mean they just like literally hung out by crowds of people and just were calm while other stuff was going on? Wow. Yes. Isn't that great?
Yep. Just in a down. So one was by my husband and I was a few chairs away, and then the other one was by me.
Wow. Yeah. What a great feeling that is. Yeah.
It's great. Yeah. It was really wonderful. I was very nervous about it, because we've had a few people in and out, but not, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 people. And it was great.
Right. So no shadow chasing zoomies were going on that night.
No running into sliding glass doors. Right, no. Right. Yeah.
Right.
Oh my gosh. No. And the thing is, the dogs, I mean, they seem fine. Like sometimes in the mornings when I come in from a walk, they just go to place themselves. It's kind of like the routine now. Like I'm going to place, I'm going to take a nap, I'm good.
Yep.
It's just not a big
deal. Ironically, I've got Tex right next to me because I'm talking on my computer, and that's where he's like, oh, Jeff's talking on his computer. I'm supposed to lay down. Like, I don't even tell him what to do, you know. Mm-hmm. It's just like, I'm supposed to lay down, you know. I think it's such a weird concept. Before you had dogs that were calm in the house, and maybe shadow chasing is a little bit excessive. You know, you probably weren't like ready for that. But
no.
I think a lot of people are amazed that dogs can actually just like hang out. You know, they can just hang and be okay. It's like, obviously you go out and we'll show some video clips of you working them outside because you were nice enough to send them mm-hmm. to me. But, you know, but do you think, did you ever imagine that it's like the dog should just do nothing in the house? Or did you have this other imagination that you should always be staying busy with your dogs?
Okay, I'm glad you brought this up because yes, I did. And so when we first got them, it would be like, okay, the dog has only been napping for 30 minutes. I've got to go out and play fetch with him for 30. And now, okay, now I've got to give him a bone. Like, oh my gosh, the dog, he's probably so bored. I got to do something. I did not know that they can just hang out and it's actually really good for them mentally to just like be calm, take a nap. You know, I because I've had smaller dogs most of my life that were not very active anyway. You know, French bulldogs are, you know, got to throw a fetch a few times. But I mean, these are active dogs.
Right.
And so that was a big part of training too, was not just like the physical exercise, but also just like the mental piece of it and getting them to just calm down. And that's totally fine. And then when we do go out, like we go out, we go on the trail, we're doing 2 miles. I'll throw the ball for 20 minutes, like back and forth. We're just doing like tug, right? I'm just making sure that the moments that they are exercising, their quality.
They're valuable. Yeah. Did you ever think about the mental aspect of the dog? Is, in other words, like, okay, I'm going to train you to sit, train you to down. I'm glad you're good in your crate already. I'm going to train you to heal. Recall is not even on some people's radar. Like literally an off-leash dog coming back, that's not even on some people's radar.
I have a story.
Go ahead.
beginning days.
Right. They ended up in San Francisco, right?
Well, they ended up in the neighbor's pond. So, okay. So now, again, the female, she's a little older, so she's just kind of naturally a little more calm. But the boy, the one who would chase the shadows, he's 2 years old, just, whoa, just always on. Mm. He got out of the yard, okay? When I wasn't home, my husband and his friend were home. He ran up the driveway, and we live on a long driveway, but there is a busy road at the top, right? Right. We didn't have e-collars at this time. We hadn't worked on recall. Not really. A right. little bit.
True recall, right?
Yeah. You know. So he got out and my husband was trying to grab him, call him. Of course, he totally ignored him. The only thing I think that stopped him was he just ran straight into our neighbor's pond and he just sunk down in there, sunk, however you would say that. Right, and my husband was able to grab him out. But that was another moment of like, oh my God, this dog is just out of control and he's just doing whatever he wants. And what if he had gone up to the road? I would have never been able to even live with myself.
Right.
So just these little things that add up, but now it is much better.
Do you think the negative behavior of your dogs was a motivator? Could you like put it this way? Could you imagine if you got non-fighting dogs and you probably wouldn't have as well-trained dogs as you do now?
No, definitely would not. Definitely would not. So not happy that it happened.
Right.
But in some ways happy that it did, because it forced me to learn more, to understand more, to take action. And you're right. I mean, again, they're good in the crate. They were fine with people. They were okay on the walk. I mean, they didn't heal, but they were fine. So yeah, I probably would not be where I am now.
Right. So. I'm going to show a video now of, I think it's, I'll let you,
That's it. June. That's the girl. She's a little easier.
Right. But this is off-leash hiking. Mm-hmm. And to a lot of folks, and I'll play it one more time. It's a short video. It doesn't look like much, but it actually is a lot, I think. Just being able to walk amongst the woods with your dog casually. And I think there's one more of you. Yeah, here's another one out in the woods. Mm-hmm.
Yep. 2 different days. Yeah, she loves it.
Just walking, like, I take it for granted, and maybe you do too by now. Maybe you're just like, what else would they be doing? You know, they're it's not free time. We're walking now. Yeah, that's beautiful to see. That's beautiful to see. Let's see a couple more videos, and you can MC these. This is just you in a field.
Yep, just in a field. I didn't have her in a heel. She was just walking, so we're just practicing small recalls and then just in a heel. Yeah.
And you know, you can tell that there's a connection there between the two of you. Did you have that? Did you have that before, or do you think that was through training?
I think that was through training. I think this dog in particular is a little more connected. Mm. You know, the other one that chases shadows and stuff, he's just a little, he's a tougher dog. I'm not going to lie. He is very tough, which has been interesting as well. Training two very different dogs, especially the first time. And at the same time, now would I adopt two dogs again at the same time? And Jeff, don't lecture me now, okay, on this. But it's, I have learned a lot. I've grown as a person, but yes, the training has definitely, definitely helped our relationship.
Well, you were forced into it. That's why I think, you know, for someone to take action within 2 months, I think is pretty good. I mean, we get people that start training on day one, but that's such a minority. I think a lot of people get dogs and are just like, okay, great. I got my dogs, and they go years without doing anything. Sometimes the whole lifetime of the dog. There's one more video that you sent me, which again is a nice open field. And if you look where my current, the dogs are way out there. At least one of them is, I know.
Yep. That's Cash. And we've had to work very hard on recall with him because he is.
Yeah, buddy.
He does what he wants when he wants.
Wow. That's a recall. Beautiful. Beautiful. Yeah. Great job. Well, you should be super proud of that. That's for sure.
Yeah. Very, very happy. And I will say, though, it is a lifestyle. It's not I trained him. Cool. It's done. I mean, we work on it every day, like on the weekends, you know, whether it be I want to socialize them by running to the Home Goods for an hour, or we run them up to Home Depot on a day where it's raining, or we're out in the fields, or we're watching the kids' soccer game. I mean, it is constantly training all the time.
It rains in Seattle?
Who would have guessed? I know. Who would have guessed?
Yeah.
I know. So, it's so weird. I know. You down in Florida.
Yeah. But so, Kelley, when you say things such as it's a lifestyle, I mean, I say the same thing. But could you talk a little bit more into that, because that makes some people interpret that as, do you mean I have to work these dogs 24/7 nonstop? Can you explain, like, in your world, because obviously you have a life, I'm sure you're married, I'm sure you have date night and do things without the dogs, but, and then you do like things during the day. Can you explain dog training is a lifestyle. Like, what does that mean in your world?
So that just means on, you know, when I get up for the day and I am going to go take the dogs for a walk, and it's a structured walk. So it's not a, hey, they get to just run around and be foolish. Like, no, we're either healing or we are, you know, doing some sort of training, whatever that is, out on the walk. We come home and they go in place for a few hours while I'm working. Then we might take a break, do a quick training session. Occasionally I'll do like training with their meals. It just depends like what I want to do for the day. Then, you know, they're on place most of the day, taking a nap. We go out again for another walk, or we might go out and do recall in the field, like in the videos you just were showing. And then it might be, you know, they're on place while we're watching a show at night. It's really just everything has a purpose, I think. And when we go out, like if I want to, you know, go out for lunch with my husband and we don't want to leave the dogs at home, they go out with us, but they have to be in a down when they're out with us. They can't just
How awesome is that?
Yeah. They can't just go say hi to the dog at the other table. I mean, and that's what I mean by lifestyles. It's just more of, we're just always incorporating the training and making sure we are, adding the training into our daily activities. So
when you're those first 2 months with your shadow chasing and then eventually fighting dogs, did you ever imagine you and your husband and the dogs would be sitting in an outdoor cafe like just chilling?
Well, I thought we might, but I was always nervous at what their behavior might be.
Mm-hmm. At least so you were thinking right, at least. That's good.
I may have said, hey, we're going to do it.
Yeah,
but that doesn't mean it would have been pretty.
So. Right. Right, but at least
not responsible of me.
You have the right attitude, at least. That's great.
Yeah. I probably would have done it once and cried and never done it again. So that.
Well, I think there's people that are the opposite. They're like, my dogs would never be able to do this. And I'm like, well, then of course they won't. You know what I mean? It's like, you're right. They won't, because you already, you know, whether you think they can or they think they can't, both of you are right. You know, there's a Thomas, who said that? Jefferson, Ford, Lincoln, anybody. but I think it's the kind of thing where it's like, you just made it, you put a priority on it that made it happen. And mm-hmm. You're only 6 months in.
Yeah.
I mean, this is just the start. Mm-hmm. Just imagine where you're going to be 6 months from now. Yeah.
I'm glad you say that, because I feel like I took on a majority of the training. My husband obviously did training, but I put it on kind of my shoulders to be the one to lead the charge. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he even said about a month ago, he's like, oh my God, Kelley, like these dogs have come so far. Mm-hmm. Like it's unbelievable. And I think because I'm in it every day and like, see, it's hard for me to, I do see the changes,
got it.
But it's hard for me to really kind of see, hey, this is where they were at 4 months ago, 6 months ago. And now here they are. And I think that he reminds me, just like you're reminding me, that it has only been this amount of time and you have come this far, and they're fantastic. And who knows, in 6 months or a year, however long it is, what else they can learn, how awesome they will be, because some days are better than others. And I think that's part of the process. I wish I had perfect dogs all the time. Unfortunately,
I wish I did too. Yeah.
Still push. You know, they're still going to try it. They're still going to see, they're going to test you. Are we still doing this down thing, mom? I don't know. Yes, it's not changed.
Yep. They'll still test you. That's wonderful. Yeah. So it's interesting though, because you're in it. So you're working from home and your husband's working out of the house.
He works from home. But my job is just a little more free and when I can get stuff done.
Sometimes
I can get things done, you know, kind of later in the evenings or early in the mornings working on projects, whereas he has like a lot of meetings typically stacked back.
He's noticed a big improvement and you did not, because you're living it more than he's observing. Not to discount the help that he's giving. Interesting. So yeah, I mean, I'm surprised that in 6 months. So has there been any inkling, because you understand what loading is now, because we went over that a lot. Has there been any inkling that any of those fights are going to happen, or do you find yourself looking at them like, that's your pre-fight look, I need to shut that down, which is good that you understand what that is. But are we clear of that yet? Or are we still like concerned that
we're clear of that? Yeah. And I think the thing that we've noticed with these dogs is that they get aroused very easily. Very easily. And so the out command has been great, because if we just need to stop a situation from even starting, because a lot of times we don't even really let them like play rough, because I just don't really, I still just don't really trust that it might not.
It might be too soon. No, that's smart. It might be too soon. When you have fighting dogs, I mean, earning that trust to play in a highly adrenalized fashion, where tons of dogs do. Like I see dogs play like, my dogs used to play where people thought they were fighting, and I'm like, no, that's play. That's play. But I think in your situation, but they've also never fought, you know. But in your situation where they have fought, I mean, you know, that's got to kick in where you're like, I do not want to be breaking up a dog fight today. So, can you explain like the out command is used in many, because we did it with food. But when they're playing maybe a little bit too rough for your, you know, taste at the moment. And when you say out, they've been trained now to just like stop and like move away from each other and just like stop the arousal.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Nice.
Yeah. And that has helped a lot. That's helped a lot. Even not just that, but, you know, moving away from people, if we had like a guest and we wanted them to move away from that guest, or, like the male specifically, when he would play with toys with his ball, he wouldn't let it go.
Mm.
You know, he would just continue to hold on to it. And so I use it with that, which has been great as well. So it has a lot of uses. And I really am glad that we learned how to do that and that we had your help too, because there were just little things that I didn't realize I was doing wrong.
Yeah, I mean, I love that. The out is a great command, because like you said, you went from stop playing and move away from each other and be calm to dropping a ball, and it's the same three letters. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and that's what I love about the out, and moving away from, and you went over and you're spending a little bit too much time sniffing and saying hello to a guest and they look a little bit irritated. And you just say out and then they move away from the guest. I love that command. And that goes back to where I think it's like, why don't you have different, like, how does the dog know to drop the ball, but to move away from the guest and to stop? It's like, cause there's context. I mean, I mean, they're not like, everybody says how smart their dogs are. It's like, well, cause your dog is like, you just said one hand, your dog is smart. And the other hand, how does the dog know the difference? It's like, well, cause it's smart, right? That's a story we're sticking to. So that's great.
Yeah.
Proud of you. Wow. What a change. What a change.
Yeah. You guys are wonderful. So happy. I would recommend, cool. I've even had people just kind of send me DMs. Like when I posted the one of June walking on the trail, you know, people were like, oh my God, like I want to do that with my dog. I'm like, oh, yeah. You know, this is what I use. And I've even had people on the recall. It seems like people struggle with recall a lot.
Oh, that's probably, leash reactivity is probably, leash reactivity separation anxiety, I think, is huge, because most people actually don't take their dogs off leash. So knowing that like your dog has got separation anxiety, which is common because the dogs are in the house or in a crate, and then leash reactivity because dogs go for walks on leash. Those are the two big ones, but there's a lot of people that would be like, oh, I would never take my dog off leash. And I'm like, that's really sad. That's really, really sad, because even in an enclosed soccer fields, you know what I mean? It's like that's too bad, because your dog could come back to you, you know, quite, you know, it takes work, but technically quite easily.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. And I will say, I think I'm a little more conservative in my, like, for example, you know, we aren't walking them off leash down the city streets.
Right.
You know,
right.
Like I'm just not there, but well, I'm so happy to be able to take them, you know, to the middle school soccer field, and I can just let them run and sniff, and I don't have to be like on them about, you know, being next to me. And I think that that's been a really great balance of, you know, walks where they're in a heel and it's very structured. And then also, yes, we get to go out and they get to do the sniffing and this running around and having fun. And so we wouldn't have been able to do that without the recall, you know, when he ran into the pond, for example. So we've come a long way from that.
Right.
It's great.
You know, one other thing, it's like where there's someone agrees with, because there's a ton of people that don't like, you know, shock collars, electric collars, and that's for another discussion for every day of my life. But
I hear you.
But what's the feeling of like when that dog was across the field, that little speck that we watched? Mm-hmm. Which one was it?
And there was no remote on that, by the way.
This one right here?
Mm-hmm.
Like, how awesome is this feeling, knowing that you can just say your dog's name and then hear, and your dog comes flying to you? Like, how awesome is that to feel?
I love it. I'm just so proud of him, because it's very, for him, it has been very hard. He went from a dog that would chase, you know, light that's reflecting off your watch on the wall to, you know, out. We live, you know, in this like kind of outdoor type place, just very almost, it's not foresty, but you know, just a lot of nature here. And I mean, even on a sunny day, he would just chase any sort of like a shadow of a bird going across. I mean, he's just come a long way. I know we still have a ways to go, just some things we can do, but it's amazing. I mean, he came back and he had his remote collar on, but I did not press anything. He just came back.
I think that's a big misconception, is that the dog only listens because they're being shocked. And it's like, looks to me like the dog, whether he was or wasn't, but he wasn't, but it looks to me like he came back because he's been trained to come back.
Yes.
I mean,
I hope so. I hope that's why he came back. He used to ignore me, so I think it's working.
I think you've done an incredible job, and I think you've done it in an incredible short amount of time with two dogs. You should definitely be proud of yourself. And what's your, okay, when these fights were happening and the stress was going on, did it affect your relationship with your husband? Or did you both get on the same page really, really quick?
Well, the first 24 hours were very stressful because we, of course, had to have the conversation of what do we do?
Right.
We didn't want to send them back or give them away. That's not something we wanted to do, but that crosses your mind.
Absolutely.
Only because you're like, well, I want them to be safe. That's it. At the end of the day, I want them to be safe, and I want this to be a good, loving home and environment for them. So is it best for one of them to go? But then it was discussed, and the answer was no. We're not letting them go. We made a promise that we would take them in and care for them until, you know, their time is, they're no longer here. And so then the next step was, okay, well, what are we going to do? So we were on the same page, which is good. I mean, I know that that can be stressful sometimes for folks who aren't on the same page. So we are very lucky in that sense that we both decided, no, we're going to work on it. We're going to figure it out. You know, I did a lot of research on how we were going to do that, but yes, we were on the same page, luckily.
That's great. I think that's a very missing conversation, that folks are, of course you want to be dog centric, but like we're talking about the marriage, the relationship, the like, you know, you both work at home. So it's like, it's a 24/7 lifestyle with your dogs and with your spouse, and to not be on the same page, which nobody takes into consideration. They only worry about the dog. And it's like, this dog is destroying this family. Like, it's literally destroying this family. I don't think anybody signs up for that unless they want to move. They want to leave their spouse, and they're like, let me get a really badly behaved dog. And it's like,
I found the solution.
That's right. That's right. Damn, I'm couch surfing within a week. This is great. So I think that it's great that you were on the same page. And I think, like, there's so many pluses to those dogs fighting at 2 months old. There really is. I mean, 2 months into your acquiring them, it's like it forced you to buckle down on training, have good communication with your husband, find a training program that was effective and worked, not get too emotionally, what's the word? The reason why you did the intense training, because it was emotional and you had a good goal in mind, but you didn't let any negative emotions of feeling bad for the dogs, if they maybe liked it or didn't like it. I think it sounds like your eye was on the prize instead of maybe like, sorry that this sucks. And I always like to compare it to anybody that does. I used to do triathlon. So, you know, anybody that's ever done, you know, I mean, Tuesdays was stair day and I did it till I threw up. And it's just like anybody that's ever done anything competitively or challenging, it's like, sorry, the training sucks and the competition might suck, but it does end, you know. And I think at the end of the day, which we're not even close to right now, like things are looking pretty good, Kelley.
Mm-hmm, they are. But you know what, Jeff? You know what's worse than doing the training or maybe, you know, some tough love is dogs fighting. It's like, okay, well, you know, I who knows? I mean, you can't risk it.
I deal with some of the worst of the worst, and living I mean, I've got families that have been living for 6+ years with dogs biting them. Dogs biting their teenagers, dogs biting every guest that comes in the house, not being able to have people over the house, not being able to take their dogs anywhere. I mean, people are they're in such, I don't even know if it's denial. It's obvious. I mean, it's how, like, the dog bit somebody. Like, you can't deny that. Like, I can't think of an excuse, you know, that's a conversation for another day about how soft I think we've gotten mentally, at least here. You know, ironically, I talked to somebody from Ukraine today, or yesterday. I did a consult, and I'm like, we have to do this quick because the electricity is going to be shut off. And I had an email right after her saying that as soon as I got off the call with you, the bomb started exploding. And here we are worried about, like, our problems. You know what I mean? Meanwhile, she's trying to get her dog from not being dog reactive. It's like, again, so the same, like, the problem is the same, but the worldly concerns are totally different. But she's working extremely, extremely hard. She's part of Patreon. You might know who I'm talking about. It's really, really incredible. Well, I'm excited that, number one, you came on. Thank you. I really, really appreciate it. But I'm excited about the quickness. I didn't realize it was that quick. I really didn't realize it was that quick. Wow.
But you know what I will say? Yes, we kind of talked about the dogs fighting and how that led us here. But knowing what I know now, any dogs in the future, it won't take something happening for me to train them from day one. So you talking about folks who are waiting years to do it, I think just do it. This is my, like, Kelley Wentworth telling people, right. And people send me and I tell them too. Or they just got a puppy. I'm like, train your puppy. Now I've always been this big pet insurance. Like, I'm so passionate. I'm like, you got to get pet insurance. And now I'm like, you've got to train your dog. You have to train your dog.
Right,
it's
right.
So that's my encouragement to everyone. It just is so rewarding for you. It's great for the dog. You'll just feel so good about it. And that's my note for the day.
I think it really builds the relationship. I mean, how could it not? I mean, just doing stuff with your dogs is like, I mean, tomorrow, Angelo and I, Joelle is still out of town. Like, we'll bring both of our dogs to our favorite cafe, Amuse 5. And we'll just hang out with them. And Angelo will read and I'll get office work done. And whether we sit inside or outside, they let us come inside. They've got really cool antique furniture. We sit inside and the dogs will just lie down and we'll get work done. And people see us and people will talk to us. They actually don't know we have dogs there, and they're huge dogs. But the way they sit and we finally leave, they're like, oh, you have dogs? I'm like, yeah, we have dogs. Like, we would have never known. It's like, that's the goal. It's like, I assure you, if they were running down the beach, you would know, but we're not. We're at a cafe, which is what I really try to preach, like that on off switch. So it seems like you're getting a really good handle on it. So
that's another good point too. I actually had someone the other day in a neighborhood, their dog was in the yard, obviously well-trained. It was just sitting at the fence looking, but I was walking the dogs and the guy was like, wow, like well-trained dogs. And I know you say it all the time. It's like the standard now is to have a dog that's not well-trained. That's so interesting.
Yeah. So interesting. It's interesting. Yeah. On the West Coast, like, because I've spent enough time in Seattle and it's concerning the element of dog training out on some of our West Coast cities, it's almost like taboo to be successful. I mean, it's sort of like, it's so weird, you know, it's like, it's so weird. Yeah. So
I know it's even sometimes living here, we live in, we don't live in Seattle now. We live in Kitsap County, which is a little more rural, which I enjoy. Oh, okay. But even sometimes just having the prong collar on the dogs, I'm just always thinking like, oh gosh, like, is someone going to say something?
Right.
And that's so unfortunate. I mean, I don't care. Like, I'm going to go out with it.
Do you still think that? Do you still think it?
I mean, sometimes. Sometimes. It doesn't matter because I know how great the dogs are. And it's not like I'm yanking my dog all the time. It's just, right. you know, it does help him just understand like, hey, this is what we're doing today. But it does cross your mind. And I think it is just all of that, the, everything you see on social media and just the negativity and you
yeah.
just, I've never had anyone say anything to me. You know, everyone's been great over here, but you just never know. I just don't, yeah. don't have to deal with it.
It is weird. It's weird because Joelle had, this is when we had a born trained dog here, had three of the dogs at the preserve with Angelo, and Angelo was on this equipment there. And she was talking to these three women that were sitting on a bench, and they literally were constantly complimenting all the dogs, how well-behaved they were, well-trained they were. Like, you know, this went on for a while. And then they're like, at the end, how did you do it? And she was like, oh, well, like, we trained them. And, you know, we trained them on remote collars, and their faces dropped. And it's yeah. just like, it's like, what happened to all of the, you know, ironically, in the same sentence, they said, you know, they, Angela started, it's funny because Angela was talking to them for a long time, and he was talking about bird watching of all things, which is like, okay, Ange, if you're 10 years old and you want to talk to a group of senior citizens about bird watching, you go right ahead, you know. But it's like, and they're like, you know, saying, wow, he's just so polite and well-spoken and smart, and he's like, yeah, he's homeschooled. And they're like, and it's funny because a lot of people are negative towards homeschooling. I think it's becoming more popular after the last few years, you know. But they're like, thank God, don't ever put him in school. So it's just funny how, it's so funny how passionate people are about, you know, mm-hmm. about certain things and their preconceptions about, you know, certain things, and just keep doing what you're doing. And you're the best.
Yeah.
I mean, you're the best advertisement for training, and you will affect other people's lives just by sight, Mm-hmm. Like, they'll see you and they'll see your dogs, and they'll either see a tool on the dog. Cause people say this to me, I see all these well-behaved dogs in my neighborhood wearing prong collars. I never thought about getting a prong collar, and I got one. I'm like, I mean, you never spoke to anybody about it? Well, they're like, well, no, I went online, but no, I actually never was quote unquote convinced by anybody. I just mm-hmm. saw, I'm like, why am I seeing all these well-behaved dogs wearing training equipment looking happy? And I'm seeing these other dogs, literally the dogs do look happy pulling their owners down the street. They're frustrated, but they don't look miserable, but the owners look miserable. So, yeah. I think people are, that's the best advertisement, is just by just existing out in public. So mm-hmm. good for you.
Yeah. And yeah. I'm whatever anyone wants to do with their own dogs, I'm totally supportive. Like, do what works for you.
Correct.
But I just think everyone should stop judging others for what works for them. You know, we all just want to live a good life with our dogs, and you know, however that needs to work is how it should be.
Agreed. We don't know what happens, you know. Your dog could look perfect on a walk, but for all we know, it just came out of surgery for ingesting three socks, you know? So you don't know, you don't know what you don't know. So, well, Kelley, thank you so much for coming on the show. I really, really appreciate it. And
thank you. It was so great. And thanks for all your content. And one final thing I have to say, I was going to mention this earlier, is that your courses are so affordable and so, that's one of the reasons I purchased, because it was such a small investment and there were other courses I saw that were so much more. And I was just like, you know, I just think that this is going to be what I need. So I just wanted to thank you for putting out not only free content, but stuff that is just accessible to a lot of people. It's just really great. So thanks for everything.
Thank you. That's the idea. We're looking for quantity, to help as many people as possible. Knowing that I was going off the road doing seminars, I was like, how can we still help people? That's why we're doing this live e-collar training, which starts.
I'm joining just because it's like only $100 or whatever. And I just love to see you guys in action. I just think there's little tidbits I can take from it. So you'll see me there.
Yeah. You'll see Joelle yelling at me live. You'll see her yelling at me live. So.
That's really why I signed up. In case you're wondering.
Probably that'll be half the business. Is like, oh yeah, we get to see Jeff get yelled at by Joelle. That's worth the price of admission right there. So,
yeah. Well, I'm very excited about it. I think it's a fantastic deal. I'm so excited to see you guys do what you do, and I just love everything that you guys put out. I think it's amazing.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here. I really, really appreciate it. So congratulations. I'm really proud of you, and tell your husband congratulations too, and tell him he should be showering you with dinners out because of all the hard work that you've been putting in. Okay. All right.
I'll tell
him. Fantastic. All right. I'll talk to you soon.